All right, Happy New Year to everyone. Happy New Year, Happy New Year. Folks, I am so excited. Well, first of all, I want to give glory and honor to God for just allowing me this opportunity, and thank you, Pastor and First Lady. I am a product of theirs. And I'm proud to say that. Because if it wasn't for them, I wouldn't be doing this. And of course, some others, you know, in the house too, they know who they are. But I am really grateful. And I just want to let y'all know that I love y'all. And I'm just so blessed and honored to be under your wing. Amen. 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 Yeah, man, it's good to be here. It's good to be here. You know your pastor's cool when he gives his wife some dap. You know what I'm saying? You know, give me five. You know the pastor's cool, you know, if he's going to give his wife some dap, you know. Okay, now, you know, obviously God had ordained this opportunity for me. And any time I get an opportunity to speak, I never take it lightly. I never take any opportunity of his lightly. I have labored, and I'm not just saying me, but I labored, I studied very hard for this moment, you know, and I believe that God is just going to release some things, amen? He's going to release some things because it's a new year, y'all, amen? And it's 2017, and then they say on the clock it's 5777, you know, and so some things are going to happen in this year, y'all, and we have got to be ready to act. We have got to be ready to move, and it can't be the same old, and that. So that's why I just want to clear the air that I have searched my heart, and I said, God, if there's anything in me that does not deserve to be up here, or I'm speaking out of my flesh, then, Lord, I will sit myself down. Y'all hear me on that? I would sit myself down because I'd rather get out the way and let the Spirit move. But if the Spirit's going to move through me, then I want to be up here. Amen? Amen? Okay, so now I believe. Now, we've been talking about revival for quite some time in this house. And I believe that revival is twofold. Pastor said he's always living in revival. Amen. Praise God. You know, but revival is twofold. Revival is corporate, but revival is also personal. Yes. But it starts off with the personal and then it merges into the corporate. Amen. So before we get into it, let's just come with an open heart and let's come with an open mind. Forget Willie Tillman up here. Okay, just forget that I'm even here. I'm just a puppet, y'all. I'm just a puppet. I'm just a little messenger boy. That's all. It ain't nothing special about me. I'm telling you this. There's nothing special about me. I'm just the average Joe. But when God puts his super on the average Joe, that super average Joe becomes the supernatural. So I'm planning on operating in the supernatural this morning. Amen. Okay. So let's pray. Father, in the name of Jesus, Lord, thank you again for what you're going to do in this house, Father God. And I pray that the word that goes forth this morning, Father God, may it change all of us, not just some of us, but all of us, Father, because there is a move and a shift that has taken place in the heavenlies, Father, and you're already in pockets visiting the earth, Father God. There's revivals going on all over the place, Father God, but Lord, we want it to come right here to the low country. We want it to come right here into this house. Lord, even more personal, we want it to come right here in our hearts, Lord. Because, Lord, church as usual is not going to do it in this era. So I pray, Lord, that when everything is said and done, Lord, that the word that was sown into each and every one of our hearts would take root and grow and begin change in our lives, Father God, for the better, for you, Lord, not for me, not for Pastor, not for our wives or our children, but for you first, Father God, that our lives would be, as Pastor always says, a living epistle read by all men. So I ask this blessing upon your word, Lord, in Jesus' name. And all God's people say,
amen,
amen, amen, and amen. Well, you know, I don't know, but I guess the Lord just led me to do this. And I'm just going to kind of take it way back. I'm going to start off talking about what was the Great Awakening, and then how the Great Awakening merged into revivals, and then from the revivals, what spawned off from there. So that's what I want to kind of talk a little bit about first. And I always don't like reading from sheets, but this was so good and so informative that I just had to do this. So everybody say, Great Awakening. Come on, the Great Awakening. The first Great Awakening happened between 1720 and 1750. And some of y'all heard names like Jonathan Edwards, George Whitefield, William Tennant, and these were some of the most prominent men at that time, where God just, God is just, he's so unique. He just shows up when he wants to show up. And these men sought God. They weren't nobody special, just average dudes. But one day, God just showed up. They were seeking his face, and he will just show up. And isn't that encouragement right off the top, that you don't have to be anybody particular, that you don't have to be anybody special, but if you're seeking the face of God, eventually he will show up. Come on, everybody say, show up. He will show up, and that's what he did in the first Great Awakening. The awakening was termed great because it was general and it was wide-reaching, okay? Now, the people from a broad spectrum of American life were impacted by the movement. There is no doubt that the Great Awakening played a large role in developing national consciousness amongst the different colonies, binding people together in a common belief, watch this, that God had a special destiny for America. Okay? Amen? Now, you need to know that at the same time as God is binding this house together, because, see, this word is specifically for us. Because we know that more people are going to come eventually. We know that God's going to move. At least that's what we're believing. That's what I'm standing on. And I think a lot of us would agree on the same thing. So there's going to be other people that's going to come. But this is just for the house. This is just family conversating. You know how y'all always have it, every now and then you get together, the family get together, and we have those family powwows? That's what we're doing, okay? And this is specifically for a purpose, so that, again, God's special destiny for the shield of faith could be enacted, and it already is. It's some things that's moving. I'm not saying nothing's not moving, but it's a greater impact that we can make, folks, because we serve a great God. I don't serve a small-time God. I don't serve a wimpy God. I don't serve this God that's just don't have nothing going on. I serve, the, as Michelle said, the same God who constructed the universe, the same God who spoke and the stars came, the same God that said, let there be and there was. That's a great and mighty God that we serve. Amen. And it's our responsibility, church, to find out who is this great God and how can I get to know you and what is it that you want me to do in this last hour, Father? Because I know that you're coming back. I know that you're coming soon. And, you know, and it gets so frustrating because you hear about the revivals of this era and the revival of this era. And I see it over there. But I'm like, Lord, you know, thank you. I'm experiencing personal revival. But, Lord, I want to see you move in a great way, because there's lots of people lost in the low country. Hallelujah. There's a lot of people that's lost, and so I want to play my part. I want to take my role, and when your spirit drops, I want to be right in the middle of it. Amen. See, and y'all heard me say this before. See, when I was out in the world and I was out partying, I made sure that I want to be right in the middle of the party when it's jumping. Oh, when they're throwing their hands up, oh man, I'm right there, bouncing right with them. You know, getting busy. But then, you know, and we do all these things when we're in the world, but then when we come to church and we become a Christian, now we don't lose that fire. We done lost that desire. We're not even getting busy for the Lord. We hardly even pray to the Lord. We hardly talk to the Lord. We hardly read the word. And then you wonder why God's not moving in your life. You wonder why God's not doing nothing in your family. We need revival, y'all. It's not an option. It's not an option to serve God. I mean, it is your choice, but if you're a Christian, then you already signed your name on the line. And it's been signed, watch this, in blood. The blood of the Messiah, amen. Come on now. Okay, let's move on. Oh boy, I'm sweating already. Okay. Now, what emerged in the Great Awakening was not so much a substitute theological system, but a new mood. If anything was a revolt that placed the view of Christian life focused on the out. So basically, what they're saying is, if there was something ought, it was more so on the so-called outward appearance of Christianity, but the Great Awakening focused on the inward man, the inward heart, folks. And that's where God's going to do his greatest work, is in your heart. Amen. And as he starts to do that work, and as we allow him to do that work, and as we allow him to mold us, and as we allow him to shape us, then he's like, oh, well, you know what? I can trust Charlie with my glory. I can trust Michelle with my glory. Now go and lay hands on the sick. Go and raise the dead. Go, because I can trust you. Because it's not so much a showy thing, an outward thing, which so many people get so caught up in. And again, let me just say this right off the bat. Now, I'm not here to condemn anybody. Right. Y'all hear me? This is not a condemnation message. But if you feel convicted, then that's up to the Holy Ghost. That ain't got nothing to do with Willie Tillman. So if there's a conviction of heart upon hearing this message, then you respond to the one that's convicting you, and that's the Holy Ghost. Don't respond to Willie Tillman. Amen? See, there is a difference between religious life and a real relationship with God the Father. There's a major difference. And it's so sad because, see, we hang our hat on our religious routines. Oh, I get up, I go to church, you know, I sing the praise, I sing the worship, I eat my dinner, then I go back home, work, here comes Sunday again, well, I get up, I go to church, I sing, you know, that's religious routines, folks. Routine ain't gonna get it. Thank you, Holy Ghost. See, it was the disciples that had a real relationship with the Father, folks. And we are called to be in a real relationship. But you know what happens? It's always that proverbial battle. That proverbial battle that goes on within our hearts when it comes to our relationship with God. Because you know what? Let's be real. Your flesh don't want nothing to do with God. Can we be real about it? You don't want nothing to do with God. I don't either, in the flesh. Is that real talk or what? Oh, ain't no tell. If I was in the flesh, oh, y'all don't even want to know what I'd be doing if I was in the flesh. Okay? Oh. Okay, Charlie. Yeah. Y'all, Lord, have mercy. Lord knows I want to. That's why I got to keep that joker beat down. You know, there used to be a song back in the day called Punks Jump Up to Get Beat Down. Well, when my punk flesh jumps up, I got to beat that joker down, because that joker is quick to take over. Amen. That joker want to run my life. That joker want to have me doing all kind of wild freaky deaky out there. You know what I'm saying? So I say all that to say, we need to focus on the relationship with our Father. Amen. That's what the Great Awakening focused on. Okay. Now watch this. Are y'all getting something out of this so far? We good? We're cruising, right? Okay, we're cruising. Okay. Now watch this. Now, the growth of the American churches and the political independence reflected what happened during the Great Awakening. So think about that. Think about that. That whole thing just influenced every aspect of our culture or of the culture of that day. It affected the families. It affected the marriages. It affected government. It affected every area of society. And so when you're operating in your anointing, hallelujah, and you're operating in your giftings, hallelujah, and you're operating in your anointings, something is bound to be affected. Amen. Amen. Someone's going to be touched, and they might not walk up to you and say, well, brother, I just want to say thank you for just being a godly man. They ain't gonna tell you that. The world ain't gonna tell you that, but they checking you. Well, let me see if this dude is who he really say he is. He talking all that Christian yiggity yak yak yak. That's how the world thinks now. He talking all that Christian yakety yakety yak, but let me see. Let me check his Facebook. Uh-oh, watch it. Willie, you meddling now, dude. Let me check and see who he really is. Because see, watch this. See, if you're operating in the flesh, you can't hide who you really are, because it's going to come out one way or the other. Now, pastor might not see it. I might not see it. We may not see it. But guess who sees it? God sees it. And when he sees it, he's going to respond to it. Hallelujah. But see, watch this. Watch this. When the Great Awakening took place, they said that bars were shutting down. I watch this. Oh, thank you, Holy Ghost. They said, watch how God just influenced mankind. That the people were so changed by the Holy Ghost that even the animals were confused, because they were so used to being cussed at and whipped and beaten. And then when the brother said, well, come on, Betsy. Come on, the Betsy looking at him like, what happened to George? What happened to George? Y'all know what happened? Matilda, do you know what happened to George? The animals were confused, amen? I mean, that is some kind of radical power, y'all. But it's not far-reaching. It's not something that we can't grab. Sometimes we think that the glory of God is so that we can't attain it, that we can't grab it, that we can't get a hold of it. But then why would he say, I've given you the keys to the kingdom, and you can go in any room that you want to? Why would he say that if it wasn't so? Amen? So obviously it is, folks. And thank God that, again, the Great Awakening was just the sparking, the igniting of something so great and so powerful and so mighty. And I believe, church, that God is doing the same thing, but he can do the same thing right in this house, right in your heart. So the question is, are you ready? I don't want nobody to speak out. You just got to ponder these things in your heart. Because see, now you're asking for something now. Remember when the man said, Elisha asked Elijah, he said, Lord, I want a double portion. And he said, yeah, you asked a good thing, but that ain't an easy thing either that you're asking for. Are you willing to pay the price? Are you willing to make the sacrifices? And it's so funny, because in our culture, we're so inundated with that. I don't know about y'all, but every now and then all the brothers would get together and we watch some football. Boy, I love some football. You know, we get together at Brother Willie's house. So if anybody want to get together, I think Willie said he having the Super Bowl at his house. So party over at Willie Wills. No, I'm just kidding. Oh, man, that dude can do some wings now. I'm telling you what. Woo! Lord have mercy. So we see athletes all the time. And these brothers, they just don't do it once a year. Their whole life is football. They eat, live, breathe, and sleep football. Just like my brother Wanye. You know, I mean, he's going to be a basketball star one of these days, Lord willing. And so you have to pay the price to be great. Oh, can we talk about that? If you want a great awakening, then are you paying the price to be great? Amen. Come on now. Don't shout me down when I'm preaching good. I'm just sharing. I'm not saying I'm all this, all that. I'm just sharing. Sometimes the Lord will just hit me at 3:00 in the morning. Get up. Well, man, Lord, I got to get up and work in the morning, man. You know, I talk to him. I'm real with him, you know. Man, Lord, it's early, but he said, get up. Okay. I'm up. What's good? I got something I want to tell you. I said, okay. I'm awake now. Now, what is it that you want to tell me? I just wanted to tell you I love you this morning. Okay, now, can I be real about it? Well, Lord, couldn't you wait till I got up like around 7 or 8 o'clock to tell me that you love me? Come on, can we be real with it now? Couldn't you just tell me that, you know, a little bit later on in the morning, you know, so I get my rest? You know what I'm saying? But he's like, no. I just want you to know how much I love you and how proud I am of you. And the best is yet to come. But now, you know, again, that's sacrifice. Because, again, if he wakes you and he wants to say something to you, are you willing to get up?
Yeah.
Are you willing to go the extra mile? Are you willing to sweat that last drop of sweat? Whatever it takes, I got to get close to Jesus. Thank you, Holy Ghost. Watch this. Remember Mary and Martha? And Martha was all all over the place. Oh, I got to cook. I got to clean. I got to do this. I got to do that. And then she went and go complain to Jesus and said, well, hey, how come Mary ain't helping me out? Who she thinks she is? And don't we do the same thing? Uh-huh. Come on now. Don't we do the same thing? Yeah. See, y'all all about shh. And then when you see the brother or sister come and cool, who y'all think y'all ain't picking up the stick, picking up the dish rag, wash, you know, mopping the floor or something? Who y'all think y'all is? But Jesus said, watch this. But she had chosen the best thing because she chosen to sit at my feet and worship me. Yeah. Hallelujah. So sometimes we just got to know what's the best thing to choose when God is dealing with us. Because there's always going to be choices. There's always going to be something that's going to come into our lives that's going to say, well, either we listen to what God is doing or we just go on about our business. And, you know, he ain't going to make us. Amen? He's not going to make us do a thing, folks. Okay, I want to hurry up and get through this because I want to get to that. Okay, well, watch this. Okay. Okay, now, one of the biggest things during the Great Awakening was the focus became the attention on the home. Watch this. As the primary place of maturity. Everybody with me? Oh, this is good. And watch this. And he was saying that this should be where every child grow up in a Christian home. Say amen. Amen. And then the brother went on ahead and said of his time in advocating a religious experience, that was the philosophically positive, that a child growing up, I've got to calm down, I'm sorry, I get so excited, that a child growing up in a religious home is physiologically positive for the child. And they saw that, watch this, proper education and responsible Christian families as the greatest opportunity for perpetuating the Christian life. Does that make sense?
Yes.
So, see, as Pastor, I think, said it a little earlier, coming here is just part of it. But the real thing happens when we're outside these four walls. Because, again, we are the church. Say, I am the church.
I am the church.
All we're doing is when we come is just a gathering together, people getting together to hang out. But your real relationship with God starts when you leave these walls and you're at home. So the question is, how are you cultivating your relationship with God when you are at the casa, as my Spanish brothers would say, when you're at home? How's that work? And how important is that to you? Because see, everything, and I'm getting a little ahead of myself, but everything and everyone knows who you really are when you're at the house. And they know what your real walk is like. And they know what your real faith is like. And they know who you are really, because they're watching. And you're setting the example. Amen. We are setting the example. And that same, watch this, thank you, Holy Ghost. And that same philosophy in which mama and daddy operate in, the little baby and the little child are going to operate, and then they're going to operate in that in their home, and it's going to keep going on and on and on and on. So your walk is just not for you, but your walk, thank you, Holy Ghost, is generational. And they say that the blessing shall be passed down to the first, third, fourth, fifth, sixth, seventh, eighth, and ninth generation. Amen. So what you do at the house is setting the precedence for everybody else in the casa. Is that real talk? Now, come on now. Don't shout me down now. I'm just being real now. If y'all don't want real talk, then I can go sit down. Again, no condemnation. No condemnation, but if there's conviction, that's not on me, okay? Amen? Okay, so I'm going to move on because I want to get to the fun part. Okay, now, so out of the Great Awakening came what is known as the revivals, okay? Now watch this. The term revival, the Latin origins, literally means to live again. Everybody say, to live again. Or to arouse. Everybody say arouse. Okay, such as when smelling salts are used to revive someone who has passed out. The term revival came into common usage in the early 18th century in order to describe what God was doing during the Great Awakening in America and in Britain. Now, in the colonies, spiritual lethargy prevailed in the churches until a spiritual awakening began to take place in New Jersey under the preaching of Theodore, Lord have mercy, this last name, Mr. Theodore. All right, Mr. Theodore. Lord have mercy. And watch this. Okay, now, and Theodore, now listen to this. Now, you know, and I know we get it all into, you know, who we are as the church and, you know, but he was a Dutch Reformed minister, okay? Now, many developed a renewed sense of their sinful condition and need for deliverance, while others were refreshed by a new appreciation for the grace of God concerning the gospel. Amen. Now, while their experiences were not uniform, but watch this. Here's the common denominator: spiritual growth. Amen. So out of every great awakening or out of every revival comes spiritual growth. Amen. And watch this. And the brother said it like this. It pleased God, watch this, to display his free and sovereign mercy in the conversion of a great multitudes of soul in a short space of time, turning them, watch this, from a formal, cold and careless profession of Christianity to a lively exercise of every Christian grace and the power powerful practice of our holy religion, as quoted by Jonathan Edwards. So again, it's time to wake up. And I'm not saying we're totally dead. I'm not saying any of those things. But I have things in my heart that need to be awakened. I can say it for myself, and I'm not afraid to. There are things in my heart that need to be shook. There are things in my heart that need to be taken care of. There's things in my heart that need not be there. There's some renewing that needs to go on in my mind, y'all. Amen. See, we all got things, and it's not a bad thing. It's not a thing where, you know, as Pastor said, God loves us. And he's so gracious and merciful that he's willing to bring the word so that we can be changed. Bless God for that. Thank God that I don't have to cry out at some altar and cut my wrist and spill blood on the altar, hoping that some God is going to come and help me. See, we just sang it earlier, we have the God of hope. Amen. And if we have no hope, the Bible says hope deferred makes the heart sick. So if your walk is sickly, then your hope is sickly. So take your hope and put it in the one that can give you hope so that you can be hopeful. Amen. Amen. Now, don't ask me to say that again, but amen. Amen. The common thread through all genuine revivals has been the emphasis on applying scriptures to the lives of the people with and without the church. In addition, the effect of revivals has been the creation of new educational endeavors. The large influx of new members into the church caused by revivals usually necessitated the training of for more ministers. Amen. Christian education, educators, and missionaries. Thus, many colleges and seminaries such as Princeton, Brown, Dartmouth, Moody Bible Institute, all of these big time, what do they call it? The Ivy League schools came out of revivals. And think about that for a second. Let that just sink in. All these big, top-notch schools were birthed out of the move of the Spirit of God. Amen? And now we look at them years later. Whew. Lord have mercy. What happened? What happened to those schools? No Spirit of God anymore? No word anymore? And see, this is what happens when we allow things other than the word and the Spirit and the power of God to keep things alive. Obviously, something or someone or something happened where the enemy, of course, we know it's all spiritual. We know it's all the enemy. We understand that. But he moved into these big Ivy League schools, and little by little, they started hiring on people that had no care for God, didn't even know who God is, and didn't even want to know who God was. And then they start spreading their mess and spreading their lies and spreading their deceit. And now these Ivy League schools that once started out by the Spirit of the living God are now dead. I'm sure there may be some remnants there. I'm sure there's some Christian workers and Christian believers that attend these schools, but it's not standing on the foundation on which it was built. That's why I continuously say, Lord, I thank you for the shield of faith, because over the years, the shield of faith has not moved from its foundation. Amen. It was built on the reaching out to lost souls. It was built on loving people. It was built on godly principles. Amen. And we have not deviated from that ever. And I don't believe, as long as Pastor and First Lady are alive, they will never move. Amen. Amen. And I thank God for that, because we're all beneficiaries of one man and woman who stood on the word of God through all the many stuff that probably came at them, left, right, upside, right side up, all the many things. They stood the test of time. Amen. And that's what faith does. Real faith will stand the test of time. Amen. Your faith shall stand the test of time. Amen. Don't let time may test your faith, but your faith tested should stand. Amen? Come on now. Somebody give God a hand clap. Come on. Come on now. We're going to have fun. I just want to lay a little foundation. That's all. We're going to get through this, and the fun part's coming, okay? Yeah, I know we normally smile and laugh and joke and all that, but let's just get through. Okay. All right. Watch this. Okay. The success of a revival is found not in how many people show up at a given meeting, nor how many followers a revival preacher can procure, nor even how many decisions can be obtained, but to what degree people's lives are changed as a result of the work of the Holy Spirit in their lives. While revivals have often started this process, it is the long process of discipleship and Christian education that brings it all to fruition. So you see how important it is that when number one, it's important for us to study. We can't be lazy in our studies, folks. It's everybody's job. Now, am I right or wrong, Pastor? It is everybody's job to pick this word up and dig into it till you mine out the gold that you're searching for. Amen. Till you mine out of the word the life that you're looking to live. Amen. Now, watch this now. Now, some people, I love the Apostle Paul. I think that he's one of the many great examples of the Bible. But somebody would look at Paul's life. I said this a couple of Wednesdays ago. Let's look at the life of Paul. Paul lived an extraordinary life. Well, wait a minute. Wasn't that the same dude that was stoned and threw out the city, left for dead? Isn't that the same dude that was whipped many times? Isn't this the same dude that was shipwrecked and just left out in the ocean just to float around? Isn't this the same dude that when he stuck his hand in the wood pile got bit by a venomous viper? Now, some people would look at that and say, well, how can you say this dude led an extraordinary life? Because look at all the mess that he got into for the gospel, for just standing up for what's right, for just being a good guy. All the mess that came into his life. But here's the message, y'all. It's what that was taking place in his heart. What was going on in the inside. He held on to the word of God. Amen. And that is what kept him going. And that is what changed him. And that's what kept him persevering through all the mess and all the rough stuff that he had to go through. And I don't know what's going to happen to America. I have no idea. Maybe more persecution might come. Lord, please, Jesus, be with the families of those that took place down in Florida. But more of that might be coming. Because here's the thing. Those cats ain't playing. That's the first thing that came to my mind when I heard that. Those people are not playing with it. You know why? Because the devil ain't playing. But see, while we're playing, and while we're just doing our so-called Christian thing, you know, the enemy is running rampant all over the place and trying to tear all kind of stuff up. But see, we're supposed to be the defenders of the good, defenders of hope. We're supposed to be one that's shining the light and leading the charge when it comes to goodness, because the devil's going to do it when it comes to destruction. And the Bible says he does what? He comes to kill, he comes to steal, and he comes to destroy. And that's all that was right down there. But Jesus says, I come that you may have life and have it more what? Abundantly. So abundant. If there's no life to flow, then what kind of life can you give? If ain't nothing flowing. So you got to take it in, folks. We got to take this thing in so that this thing can flow through us and flow to other people. Because I always heard, you know, back in the day when I was a kid, that the gospel is an offense. And I've always wondered, what does that really mean, Lord? But when you're really living as you should and doing as you should, just your presence is going to offend people. Did you know that? Just your presence. because they know there's something different about this person, and I don't know what it is. I can't figure it out. I don't know what's going on, but I don't like that joker. I don't like you. See, and there's nothing wrong with being liked, you know, because everybody wants to be liked, but then you know what? Sometimes you just ain't going to be, and I know that's not proper English, but sometimes you're just not going to be liked. Who cares? That's what I say. I don't care. Like me, don't like me. That's all right. I'm still going on. Amen. I'm going to do my thing. I don't know what y'all going to do, but I... Oh boy, these little things keep popping up. Boy, back in the day, man, there used to be this group called Tony. And they had this song called, I Don't Know What You Come to Do. I don't know. Okay, I see people bowing their heads, so I better. That means move on. I got the look. Move on, Willie. Move it on. But hey, I don't know what you came to do, but I know what I'm coming to do. I came to serve the Lord, amen. I'm going to keep serving him, amen. Okay, we're moving along. We're coming. We're getting to the good stuff. Just hang tight. Okay, that's it on revival. So everybody got a good understanding of what revival and what the Great Awakening is. And the coolest thing that, again, had come out of that is not only lives changed, but the importance of Christian education. That is so important. That's one of the things I'm so thankful that when I did start coming to church after fighting God for so long, that one of the things we had was Sunday school. And I love Sunday school. I don't know about y'all, but I get a kick out of Sunday school. You know, and everybody, and in our class, everybody teaches, everybody interacts, everybody got something to say, and it's just the coolest thing. Education is so important. Watch this. Christian education is the interaction with the truth and its implications for life under the guidance and power of the Holy Spirit, so as to affect change in the life of the learner, and this change would be conformed to the image of Christ. So that's why it's important to study. That's why it's important to learn the truths of the gospel, because you can't change if you ain't putting nothing in here and nothing in here. Amen. You're not going to change. Amen. Education is important. Educate yourselves in the truths of the gospel, amen, in the word of Christ. Watch this. Christian education is a Bible-based, Holy Spirit-empowered, Christ-centered teaching and learning process that seeks to guide the individuals at all levels of growth through contemporary teaching that leans towards the experiencing of God's purpose and plan through Christ in every aspect of living, and to equip them for the effective working of ministry. Because guess what? We are all ministers. Turn to your neighbor and say, you a minister. We are all ministers, amen. And it's the truth. It's the truth. Oh, man, it is the truth. We are all ministers. Now, watch this. Okay, here we go. Now, the last little thing, and then we're really going to get to this good stuff. But one more little piece. It's important that if we're going to study the Word of God, and I'm not trying to get all fancy turn, but I just think that this, I just want to tap on this because I think it's important. It's important to learn what is called hermeneutics and exegesis of the Bible. Okay, now let me explain that to you. Hermeneutics is the science and art of interpretation. The word comes from the Greek noun, hermeneuketos, or whatever, meaning of or for interpreting. The verb form means to explain, to interpret, or translate. Interpretation is essential to understanding the will of God. How will we know if we don't understand? Amen. Now watch this. Possession of a Bible in itself does not ensure the knowledge of God. Just because you got a Bible, that don't mean you know it. Pastor always drills. In the word. Proclaim the word. Because why? Faith comes by hearing. And hearing the word. So how much are you hearing? Amen. Okay, last little thing. For believers, it is critical, our faith is critical to understanding the Word of God. Amen? Okay, Wanya, if you put up there 1 Timothy chapter 2, verse 15. Oh, and we're getting ready to get to the good stuff. 1 Timothy chapter 2, verse 15. Thanks, Wanya. You know what? I was going to have Michelle do my Bible reading. I still might. You got the mic? Okay. Thanks, Boo. Go ahead. Yes, ma'am.
All right, let's follow along here on the screen. Mm-hmm. Nevertheless, the sentence put upon women of pain in motherhood does not hinder the soul's salvation. Oh, and...
Sorry, 2 Timothy.
Hey.
2 Timothy.
We can talk about women in pain having children, but I'd rather not.
Yeah, I'm going to be like Pastor. You know, I'm going to be like Pastor. Watch this. Oh, you know, that's a good one now. That's a good one. And, you know, we can apply that to, you know.
Love 2 Pastor. Timothy 2:15.
Just a joke. Just a joke.
Study and be eager.
Uh-huh.
Wow.
Uh-huh.
And do your utmost to present yourself to God, approved,
mm-hmm.
tested by trial,
right?
A workman who has no cause to be ashamed,
exactly.
correctly analyzing and accurately dividing, rightly handling and skillfully teaching the Word of God, the Word of truth.
That okay. And then one more, Michelle. And then John 1:14. So study and be eager, guys. How eager are you to get into this word? Amen?
John 1:14. And
yeah.
The Word, Christ,
mm-hmm.
became flesh,
mm-hmm.
human incarnate, and tabernacled, fixed his tent of flesh, lived a while amongst us,
mm-hmm.
and we actually saw his glory,
mm-hmm.
his honor, his majesty. Such glory as an only begotten Son receives from his Father, full of grace,
mm-hmm.
favor, loving kindness, and truth.
Amen. Everybody say amen.
Amen.
So when you study the Word, this is the result. When I study the Word will become flesh, and it will begin to dwell in my heart. And watch this. And as I dwell among the people, watch this. They will behold his glory. Amen. Because I'm filled with the Word. I'm filled with the Spirit. I'm filled with the glory of God. Amen. So everywhere I go, they're not hopefully they don't behold Willie Tillman, but they begin to behold the glory of God. Amen. And then they said, well, where do you get your shine from? Charles, boy, every time I look at Charles, brother, where do you get your shine from? How you see shining like that? Well, my shine comes from my Father up in heaven, amen? I shine for Jesus, amen? And everybody that looks at one of us to say, man, they are shining for God, amen? Sunshine, what's up? Sure.
Everyone can hear me better now?
Yeah.
I like to normally like play video games in the morning, wake up early before I have to do stuff. This
yes.
week, God just suddenly asked me a question randomly in my heart. And he's like, well, what's more important to you? Should you be reading your Bible or should you be doing this?
Mm.
And I've been debating whether to share that or not, but that's
sure.
that's the direct call.
Sure.
God flat out punked me and he
yes,
said,
sir.
Hey, am I more important to you than this?
Right.
And reality is, the reality of that was, how do I want to start my day? What
exactly.
is the precedent for my day?
Exactly.
No matter what our lives are.
Yes, sir.
No matter what we do. If you're
yes,
a mother
sir.
Of four children, or if you're a senior citizen, or someone my age, it doesn't
yeah.
matter.
Yes, sir.
You can choose to make time
That's right.
for God in the morning, which
yes,
will
sir.
Set the tone for the entire day.
Exactly.
It is a choice.
Exactly. That's why the Word says, choose you this day whom you will serve. Amen. So what are we serving? So the Word of God is so important. And sometimes, unfortunately, we don't hear it in its practicality. That's why it doesn't affect us. That's why it doesn't move us. But thank God for preachers and teachers and those who can actually convey the word in a way where the Holy Spirit begins to move in your heart and be like, you know what? That really makes sense what this brother or sister is talking about. Amen. And so maybe what I need to do is begin to explore what the brother is saying, explore what the sister is saying, explore what the word is saying, so that the word can get into my heart. And then as it begin to get into my heart, then all of a sudden this change is going to start to happen. And I don't want the same things, and I don't have the same cravings, and something just takes place. Something just takes over. So, you know, they used to say back in the day at the Holy Ghost party, this is a Holy Ghost takeover. Amen. So let the Holy Ghost take over. Amen. Let the word take over. Amen. Let truth take over. Amen. Because that is what's going to keep us in the end. That's how we're going to see the move of God in these last days. Amen. Amen. Come on, let's give God a hand of clap. Okay. I'm only going to be up here for just a little bit longer because I know it's getting a little, okay? So we're just going to be, to be continued, but let's go ahead and jump into it. Okay, now, based upon those two scriptures that I gave you, it, again, those two are almost like a hinge for some important principles when it comes to revival. So here's my sermon title, and you can go ahead and put it up there, Wanye, please. That first clip, please. Okay, so we're in a new year, but in this new year, we need to have a new ear, and we need to have a new heart. So everybody say, new year,
new year,
new year,
new year.
And new heart.
New heart.
Now, something the Spirit of God, when I was looking at that word heart, something just jumped out, and he just showed me some things, and he gave me a breakdown. And Wanya, if you go ahead and put that second clip, when we think about the word heart, look at all these words that come out of the word heart. Look at this: hear, ear, the word heart, and the word art. And all of these, when it comes to revival, is key to what I call ground works. And God wants to do some ground works this morning. Amen. God wants to do some tilling of the heart this morning. He wants to shake us up a little bit. You know, okay, he wants to shake us up a little bit this morning. Amen. Now, what I'm going to focus on, though, is I'm going to focus on the ear piece, and I call it earring, and we're going to focus on the hearing, and we're going to focus on the heart. Now watch this. See, we just can't hear the word, but we got to become an active listener of God's word. So what happens when the word comes to you? What is happening? What happens when the word comes into your heart and into your mind, into your spirit? What is taking place? Do we allow it to take itself to the next level? Or does it just sit there?
New life.
Amen. And my sister said life too as well. So there should be some new life happening. Amen. This means that not I am engaged in and I'm participating in the conversation with the Holy Spirit and with the Word of God. This is where the wrestling comes in. See, change only comes when you wrestle that word. Come on now. You got to wrestle that doggone joker. You got to dig out on that joker. You got to make sure that, because see, I got something inside of me that's trying to wrestle to get out of me. Old Freddy Krueger's trying to jump out of Willie Tillman. Amen. But I got to wrestle that joker with the word, and I got to beat this joker down. Anger, you're not going to get the best of me because the word of God said. See, that's the intensity of the fight, though. See, you can't come to church ready to fight. You can't live your Christian life if you ain't ready to fight. Because it is a fight. Because I guarantee you, I'm going to put it on me. Because sometimes I put, if somebody comes up to me, God forbid, and this joker decides to sucker punch me, I got to think about that one. I got to walk, Floyd. Lord, no, this joker just did not sucker punch me. Okay, Lord. Okay, Lord. What does the word say? Be angry and not sin. Okay, Lord, I'm trying not to be angry because I don't want to go to jail. I don't want to put nobody in the hospital. I'm trying to be easy. Isn't that real, though? Isn't that how we think? Yeah. Come on now. I mean, I know somebody. Well, I don't know about y'all, but I'm talking about me. You go ahead and hit me like that. Well, I love the Lord now. I say hallelujah. I say God bless you. But you just sucker punch me, dude, and I'm, you know. But watch this. Thank you, Holy Ghost. But watch this. The devil is sucker punching you every doggone day, and you ain't doing nothing. And we just let him sucker punch us with this and that and that and this. And we just sit there, well, he hit me. That joker just hit me. I can't believe, Lord, he hit me like that. And the Lord looking at you like, what you gonna do? Punks jump up to get beat down, you know? What you gonna do? You know? This is a real fight, y'all. This ain't play. This ain't make-believe. This ain't Mr. Rogers. This is a real battle that's going on out here in the atmosphere, out here in the heavenlies, and the enemy is doing his darnest to kill you, to steal from you, and to destroy you. So the thing about it is, what you gonna do with your fight? I know what I'm gonna do with mine when that joker try to come my way. I know what I'm gonna do. So, but see, watch this. But if I'm just hearing the word, see, I hear the sound of the snapping, but when I hear the sound, now my feet want to move. My feet are going to respond. My body's going to respond. My mind's going to respond to the things that are coming inside my hearing. And that's why we got to fight this good fight of faith. Amen. So we're in a new year, y'all. New year, a new ear, and a new heart. Come on now, let's let that sink in. A new year, a new ear, and a new heart. I got more in store, but I just want us just to settle on that just for a second. We're just going to wrap it up, and we're going to continue part B next week. But think about all. See. When I think about God, yeah, I love the blessings and I love all of that. That all comes with it. But you know what? I want more than anything. I just want to be close to Jesus, as close as I can get. If I got to lay at His foot, if you just let me hold your big toe, I'd be all right. You know what I'm saying? I just want to be close. You know, I need to be close. Amen. Because there's some wild things that goes on, you know, in this world today. I mean, it just swirls all around you. Woo, 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 woo. And if it wasn't for the grace and the goodness of God, amen. And if it wasn't for these principles, this groundwork that is taking place in my heart, there's no way. Because I guarantee you, Pastor can tell you, some of these folks can tell you what I was like when I first started coming here. And it's not about me, but I hope that it just testifies to the transforming, working, and power of the Word of God and the power of the Holy Ghost that gets inside a man and brings him from the depths of darkness into God's glorious light. Amen. That's the power of the Word. Amen. That's the power of truth, amen. That's the power of love, amen. That's the true power of revival, amen. Hallelujah. Because you're looking at a man that once was dead. And I mean deader than a doggone doorknob. Dead, dead, dead. Nothing. Expent. My life was spent out. But a new year, a new ear, and a new heart. And God walked up to the mouth of the grave. and he said, Willie, come out. Woo! Oh, whoa, wow, I can't believe, look at this. Look at the sunshine. Woo, look at the birds. Look at the food and the pie and the chicken. Woo, look at this. Woo, man, I'm leaping and jumping and woo, hallelujah. Hallelujah, boy, and that's real. That's real right there. So we're going to come back next week, and we're going to get to these little things, and we're going to take it up to another level, because I'm praying, let's touch and agree for revival. First personal, then corporate, amen? And the last thing, when the Spirit deals with you now, again, no condemnation here, folks, and Pastor knows my heart, no condemnation here. But when the Spirit moves, you move with Him. I got one last thing, Pastor, I'm almost done. I saw this song. Boy, I love this song. I got to end it with this song right here. There's this dude, and he's not a Christian. But I just love the anthem, though. And his name is Ludacris. Anybody ever heard of Ludacris? Come on. Everybody heard of Ludacris. And I was thumbing through the TV last night, and I thumbed it on MTV, and they were showing like all the I love the 80s, you know, and I love the 90s and whatever, right? And so I think this was the 80s or something like that, and they had Ludacris on there, and he had this song called "When I Move, You Move Just Like That." When I move, you move just like, oh, and I just love that. You know, and everybody's doing a little, you know, and I'm in my bedroom. Yeah, go ahead. But I mean, I just like the anthem, you know. So I said all that to say this. When He moves, you move. And here's your response. Just like that. That's your response to the Holy Ghost. Amen. Just like that. Just like that. Okay, so I laid the foundation of the Great Awakening and the revival and Christian education and how these things are important. And next week we will continue with a new year. Everybody? A new year, a new ear, and a new heart. God bless you. Go ahead, Pastor. More to come, more to come, more to come. More to come. Woo! More to come. More to come.
The Apostle Paul said it this way.